take a look at your money. Joining me to have that conversation this morning is an economist, and his name is Ndindi Nyoro. Good morning, and thank you for joining us this morning.
Morning to you, Mr. Getoga. Thank you very much.
Good. Let's start with loans, because I grew up in an environment where I was made to feel like loans were literally, it's like taking, a stone, a very heavy stone, tying it to your neck and throwing it into the ocean. Yeah. Is that a fact?
I think there is some fact in it, especially when you talk about personal loans, because personal loans is actually a product of instant gratification, where you want something now. If you want to drive a car, you want it now and you can't wait.
Regardless of what happens, whatever easy way I can get it, let me get it.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. But there is one segment of loans that can be encouraged, especially the kind of loan that encourages investment. For example, if you have a business and you need to expand or enlarge your business and you need more capacity, mm-hmm. you need more capital, that is allowable. But I have a big problem myself, and I'm sure even Kenyans who are viewing have a big problem when we take loans for consumerism, mm-hmm. loans that encourage us to buy expensive things mm-hmm. that necessarily do not give us value, but they are highly priced.
Let's try and divide these two kind of loans so that it's very clear, because yeah. I may argue mm-hmm. that if I am taking a loan for a car,
yeah.
it is an economic benefit to me. Reason being, uh-huh. it gets me to work on time,
yes.
or again, depending on why I'm buying the car. It may be because I am, far from where I am, so I need some convenience to get to where I'm going on time.
All right.
It helps me manage many more things. So mm-hmm. how do we divide and know this is a good investment or not a good investment?
Any loan you take that encourages you to spend more and not to make more is a bad loan. Any loan you take to buy a smartphone, for example, a loan you take to buy a sofa set,
an imported
one. But
that smartphone might be the portal that I'm using to enhance and get my more business.
Unfortunately,
it keeps me online.
Unfortunately, we don't do it for those reasons.
Okay.
Unfortunately, that car you buy, we actually never buy it for convenience. Most times we buy that car to be seen that we have a good car. And I don't think that is the right direction. But again, that's a segment of personal loans where you buy an expensive suit, not necessarily because you're going for an interview, you need to get a good job. Mm-hmm. You are just buying it mostly to show off.
To belong.
Yeah, to belong. Mm. But again, if you take a loan, for example, to use the same example, to buy a car for your business, let's say you have a fruit distribution small business and you need a small van, maybe to start distributing it to more people and more retailers, then that is a good loan. You know why? It is the same business that you repay this loan. Any loan you take, and whatever you are buying, if it's a smartphone, will not generate enough money to pay itself, then that is a bad loan.
That is a bad loan.
And it will lead you into a hole. Mm-hmm. And I've seen many people's experiences, and I am convinced a loan should always be taken when it's needed. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, we always take a loan because we qualify.
Okay. Now, your thoughts again. I do remember getting advice from an older person who mentioned, and I want to hear what your take is on this, that one of the things that makes us poor is recurrent expenses. Is that true?
It is true, especially when you, for example, move into maybe you get a promotion at work and then you get a small pay rise and you feel now I'm rich and you move estates, you move into a house that you are paying a higher rent. And maybe you get a bigger car with a bigger engine. Unfortunately, it consumes more. All those things, especially that accumulate into things that will be paid off every now and then, that is a very bad route. Mm-hmm. We should encourage more of recurrent income than recurrent
expenditure. Now, you've clearly defined and said that if you're buying or taking a loan to buy a car that is not necessarily adding to your income, that's a bad loan that you're taking.
Yeah.
And a good loan would be one that you are possibly going to make income out of it. How
exactly.
do I know a good loan, mm-hmm. depending on what, or rather, what factors should I check out for a loan? Because as much as I am taking a loan mm-hmm. for a business, it may be a very high cost that I'm paying that may not pay back later.
I think the first thing is to evaluate whether you actually need the loan, even before you go to the factors about interest rates and so. Mm-hmm. Because we rush, take loans, maybe we think our businesses need that capital. But maybe the capital that the business needs more is actually the brain. Then you go to the bank and take excess weight. Because any capital you put into the business to produce the same goods and services, then that is excess weight. And efficiency demands that you produce more using less. Mm-hmm. Therefore, it's good to evaluate whether we actually need their own first. Mm-hmm. Because, of course, the biggest beneficiaries of this loans culture is the bank.
Right.
Then unless you own the bank, mm-hmm. then you are joyriding.
Yes.
Definitely.
And they're making money out of you.
They are making money out of you.
So how do I go about calculating, or how do I know what is a loan that is reasonable for what I want to do vis-a-vis one that is maybe too expensive over time?
That's a very good question. Because I encourage business loans myself and discourage, of course, personal loans. You need to check the interest rate you're paying to the bank. For example, if you take a loan where you are paying an interest rate of 20,000 a month, mm-hmm. and then the business is generating 18,000 a month, then definitely it means you're working for the bank every day you wake up. You should therefore take a loan that generates more, because you're not a slave of the bank. Neither are you a slave
of... working for yourself.
Mm-hmm. Neither are you even a slave of your business. Mm. All those things, the business and the bank, should actually be working for you, not the other way around. Mm-hmm. Therefore, when taking a loan, it's good to evaluate whether enough money is being generated to pay up the loan and the interest rate, and then enough is left for you mm-hmm. as part of a thank you note for you taking the loan mm-hmm. and, of course, making money out of it.
Run me through the actual calculations, because what you'll find is that majority of us get into business by chance, such that you start running. Let me just use an example, a boutique. Mm-hmm. And you go to Turkey, come back, and you realize that if I had come with more stock, if I had come with more shoes, more trousers, I'd have made more.
Yes.
Because if per trouser I'm making, say, 300 shillings, or maybe let's be a bit generous and say 2,000 per trouser, if I had come with 20, mm-hmm. I would have... So you go through those mathematics, and then here is a bank, because they're looking for attagers.
Yeah.
They've pushed you an SMS and told you, you know what? You qualify for
a Valentine's loan.
of 3 million shillings.
Yes.
So when you do the calculations and think, if I go to Turkey and come back with a huge amount of clothes, uh-huh. then I'm making money. Is that a reasonable...
Mr. Getoka, unfortunately, and I've seen it, and I'm a product of it too, failures and, of course, successes. Unfortunately, we look at profit in terms of buy this and sell this.
Precisely.
We take a pen like this one, it's 8 shillings, and therefore we
selling
it at 12 bob, and we think you are making a margin of 4 shillings. Mm. But probably you are selling it in a premise that you've paid goodwill and you pay rent. You have employed someone. Probably you are also employed by the same business. You pay rent, you pay other utilities. It's good to factor in all those things, because most of the times we think we are making money. And the bad thing I've seen in business is the failure of us to take our wealth or to calculate what we are making or even to track our net worth. You just do business, but when you sit down and do the math, you actually go into circles. And Mr. Getoga, I'll give you an example, not even of Turkey, but the real one here in Kenya. Mm-hmm. When I go home, I always laugh at my mom, because you get every time there is a cow there, she's tending. When you tell her to calculate what she actually gets out of it, it's a zero-sum game. Mm-hmm. Now, this Christmas...
But for her, she wants milk. She gets milk at the end of the day.
But maybe the cost of that milk is actually higher than buying the packed one. Mm. And like this Christmas, we went home, and I'm sure I'm saying this for the benefit of viewers. Then she had some 2 pigs. To her, that's a business. And it's a business many Kenyans are doing, small-scale farming. But once you calculate the input vis-a-vis the output, then you realize you've been a slave for something that yields nothing. Mm. Actually, it sucks your blood, it sucks your energy, and you get nothing out of it.
Now, for the common mwananchi, help me calculate, or at least get a formula to know how much my input is and output. And I'll use the same example you've given of pigs.
Yes.
Because I may feel,
if I
rear this pig to a point where it is taken by those who make sausages or whatever they do, pork, whatever, they probably bite maybe, 10,000? Mm-hmm. But when I look at my input, I maybe buy grain to feed it, every so often where I maybe spend 1,500.
Yeah.
Of course, if I add it up, it maybe even go beyond 10,000.
Yeah.
But because of the convenience that I don't have to pay a lot at once, how do I actually calculate my profit?
Your profit, I will use the same example of pigs and cows, because most Kenyans have them. If, for example, you buy a piglet and you want to sell it, I'll use a more facilitated figure, maybe a number like 12 months. You want to sell it after 12 months. There are feeds, there is labor, maybe they employ you, maybe you are the only worker. You should calculate what is the current general labor cost in that area. You add it up to there. Then you need to add up even your conveniences. For example, you may have 2 pigs, but you can't even visit your daughter in Nairobi because you are tending them.
You can't leave them.
You can't leave them. Mm. So all those things, you need to quantify them. And at the end of the day, unfortunately, you realize most small businesses, most small-scale farmers, most small-scale micro-businesses, we actually make losses, but for fear of evaluating and finding out that, we live in the dark, and we prefer the dark than the light. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So how do I calculate? What is a profit? Is a profit, you give an example. Yeah, if I buy a pen at 8 shillings,
yes.
Sell it for 12,
yes.
Is that a profit?
We can call it gross profit, the 4 shillings, but of course there are other things like rent, if you have a premise. There are other things like the transportation. If you got it from the manufacturer and maybe you have a shop, all those are costs.
They need to be factored.
And I'm sure everyone with a shop or even a boutique or even a stall, they know all those costs. You should factor them in. And they actually help in determining your selling price. Mm-hmm. Because most of the time, we undersell our products. Mm. Maybe you have a book, you look at competition, they are selling it at this price, and therefore you just ride on that price. Without realizing, maybe you are just going into circles. And once you do that month, it helps you to find economies of scale, even in production of whatever you are selling. You might realize you have been buying this pen at 7 or 8, selling it at 12, and you feel you are making money. But if you calculate and realize there is actually no money being made, you may actually find more avenues and better avenues of buying the same pen at a cheaper price. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Or hiking up your price now to make money on it.
To make some margin out of it. Or even close shop altogether.
Oh, yeah, that's another option that many of us don't like to explore. Let's go back to the loans.
Yes.
So now here I am possibly thinking I need to expand my business. Yeah. First of all, what should advise expansion of a business?
The first parameter to consider is actually demand, because the business have two sides, supply and demand. The supply side is the business side. The demand side is the consumer side. If, for example, you are producing juice, whatever should lead you into expansion of that business is the consumer. If you have a bigger market and you feel you cannot satisfy the market, that is when you go into investing more. Because you may have a glut. You may have a company, you're producing these commodities. And then for the purpose of feeling you're expanding, you continue pumping in capital. Then you produce commodities or services that have no consumers. Mm-hmm. Therefore, the first parameter to consider is definitely demand. And the businessman should always test demand so that every time the demand goes higher, then you should up the supply. Mm-hmm. And upping the supply means putting in more resources. Not necessarily money, but all the other resources put together. Mm-hmm. Therefore, that is one of the considerations. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are there some scientific ways of measuring this demand? Because here I am.
Yeah.
Again, let's go back to the pigs and the cows, because that's where we started off. If I have two pigs and I'm selling them at 5,000 each and make whatever amount of money I'm making, I may be under the stupor that if I had 50, my profit goes up.
Yes.
But how do I measure the demand? How do I know that it is actually required? I may have 10 pigs, and by the time I have those 10, another 10 farmers have got another 10, such that now our pigs, we have nothing to do with them.
Mr. Getoga, I'll use the same. There is something I would call and coin as a raised demand. A raised demand, for example, you are a farmer, you are farming chicken, broilers. You can get an order even prior to having the full-grown broilers. Mm. That is a very good thing. Therefore, you actually and buy the small
chicks based on the order,
and based on the calculated demand. Mm-hmm. But of course, as a businessman, there are many scientific ways. If you go to the government data, like Kenya, you have Kenya National Bureau of Statistics, you'll get a lot of openings in terms of where to put in your money and where opportunities are. There are always those data, and you can find them. But of course, if you are in a specific business, if, for example, you are in media, you definitely know where to look for. Therefore, it's good, even if you are relying on the macro figures that you may find in the government, it's good also to calculate your own by knowing exactly if, for example, I'm producing eggs, who do I sell eggs to? Mm. And if I'm producing 1,000 eggs a day and I have a demand of 1,200, then how do I close the gap? I may not close the gap by increasing my flock. I may actually even bridge the gap by becoming a broker of the lesser demand, that is the 200.
Okay. Yeah. And maybe in retrospect, maybe especially if it's quail eggs, you know, quail eggs had a way of beating that demand. Let's look at another aspect of loans, because you'll find there are those who are in business.
Yeah.
There are others who possibly are employed, but you need a bridge in between.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is the person who's doing business may not have access to a loan.
Yes.
Because you and I know that when you go to a bank, the first thing they ask for is bank slips.
Yes, yes.
And how much you bring
pay
in.
Slip.
Pay slip, rather. How much you bring in. And here's somebody who possibly is employed, but has now access, but doesn't have the time for business.
Yeah.
Is it a safe thing to do, to take a loan on behalf of?
It is one of the worst things to do. You are taking a loan on behalf of someone. You don't own their agenda, neither do you have control of what your money or the money you've taken from the bank will be doing. A loan should always be given to the person who is demanding it, because they know what they need it for. Therefore, I cannot encourage, for example, you tell your sister who is a teacher to take a loan for you because you can't qualify to take it. Therefore, I cannot encourage that. But if it's a teacher taking a loan to do something, especially that you generate income, then so be it.
So be it.
Yeah.
Let's look at another aspect, which is now getting into partnership with family members.
Yeah.
Is that something you would advise? And the notion normally is, because we are family, we actually don't need any legal framework. We already have a legal, what did I call it?
A blood social link.
Yeah, a blood link.
I think business partnerships, not necessarily family, is something to consider very seriously. I've done something called venture capital myself. And I've realized, because I've lost money in it and made some money in it, and I realized any partnership and anything of getting together to invest is never an investment of idea first. It is an investment for that person. You invest in the person first. What do I mean? If, for example, a person here, Mr. Otieno, comes with an idea, another Mr. Kamau comes, they may have the same idea. And therefore, if you put in the money, you might think you'll get the same value. But I've seen the passion, the drive, the heart of the person is more important than actually the idea they have. Therefore, you may find some family partnerships that work very well, not on the basis of its family, but on the basis of the career of the idea. For example, if I have a very brilliant idea, for example, maybe to come up with an app to do something, and therefore I approach someone, maybe a family member, an uncle, and we join hands, we may end up making money. Not because that person is my uncle or I'm the nephew, but because of the intensity and the extensity and the workability of my idea. Therefore, business partnerships is something I've seen through experience that we take for granted. We think you are moving maybe to establish a business together with a person, and we think it's purely the idea. Let's get out of that notion. It is majorly the investment in that person. So you therefore need to evaluate the person first, even before you move to the idea. And don't get into a partnership simply or in simplicity, because this is a person I know as a friend, or this is a person I know is family.
All right, there's a tweet here from Joseph who says, I took a loan about 5 years ago and I'm getting to a point I feel I cannot pay it. Best way to pay a loan fast?
Mr. Gitoga, I think in answering that question, because I think even those people who have not taken loans, there could be many people considering of taking them. We sometimes live in this world, but we basically don't live for ourselves. We make a lot of money, like our brother who has taken a loan. Maybe they are actually employed and they have an income, but most of the time we forget to pay ourselves first. We therefore continue accumulating so many burdens, and we actually don't get any benefit out of the existence that we do on earth and out of the work we do. Therefore, maybe in brief, even if you are talking about loans, it's good for me to touch some few things. Even if you are making money out of our businesses and out of our employment, it's good to pay ourselves first. You realize if, for example, earn 50,000, 10,000 you pay rent. Therefore, that is not your money.
It's your landlord's
money. You take another 10,000, you go and buy a good suit. That is a boutique person money. It's
not your money. You're paying the tailor.
You are paying the tailor. You again take some other money to pay for your fuel for the month. That is not your money. It is money for the fuel dealer. You realize that at the end of the day, you are actually left negative, meaning all the money you make and all the income you make, you actually don't work for yourself even a bit. You work for others. Therefore, I would encourage the viewers, before you do anything, always pay yourself first. And after paying yourself a certain amount of money, then make that money work for you always. If, for example, you say every month, 20,000 or 20%, I'll be paying myself first. Make sure wherever you put that money, it is generating more money for you. And of course, for the benefit of even my own experience, always avoid predators. Because you realize, especially when you start doing well, when you start making some money, you get some very good people coming around you. Some may have good intentions.
Those are the ones you're calling predators.
Predators. Because you realize most of the time you work so hard, but wherever you put your money, and this predator may not necessarily be afraid. It could be someone out there coming with a very nice deal that you can invest in. You put in your money, maybe a loan for 5 years, you don't generate any coin out of it. Therefore, for the next 5 years, you realize you've been working for the bad idea that you invested in that you are given by a predator of your money.
Okay, yeah. So basically, what's the fastest way to get out of a loan?
The fastest way is actually never to take it, for those who have never taken it. Mm. But those who are in it, I would encourage, do not invest more outside before you clear the loan. Because sometimes we lie to ourselves that if you get a top-up, for example, to invest more in whatever we invested the first loans in, we lie to ourselves that we may end up recovering our money and pay up even the original loan. Mm. Focus any income you have in getting out of that bank and getting out of that loan, because a loan is a burden, especially a loan that is not generating income.
Income.
And then when you hear somebody complaining, definitely that is a loan that is not being able to pay for itself, or the intended purpose never materialized. Mm-hmm. Maybe the person took up the loan to buy a plot. The plot is no longer generating any income. Therefore, if it's not generating income to pay for itself, then why did you take it in the first place? Therefore, channel all the incomes you have into being free, because you are in chains first when you have a loan.
All right. Now, Richard Kiyosaki, the writer of Rich Dad, Poor Dad, encourages and says it is very difficult for you to actually go beyond a certain ceiling when it comes to financial freedom unless you take a loan. Do you agree with that?
Unfortunately, I'm never a student of Robert Kiyosaki, because I belong to other school of thoughts. Mm-hmm. There is one man I admire most. One of them is Warren Buffett. And then maybe there is a reason why he is the second or the third wealthiest person in the world.
The world.
Mm-hmm. And Kiyosaki is not even among the 10,000 wealthiest. Mm-hmm. Therefore, I borrow more from people like Warren Buffett and people like, of course, Bill Gates and other investors. It is good to invest what you have. Don't get into a rush. This world is not going anywhere. Those opportunities you are chasing, you'll be here today, tomorrow, and even next week.
But I also don't have the luxury of time because I'm growing older.
You are growing older, but believe you me, the money you have and the capital you have now, maybe the idea you have do not necessarily need more money. Maybe the idea you have needs more refining than more capital.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right, let's go back to another book, Richest Man in Babylon.
Yeah, exactly.
He also ascribes to the fact that you've mentioned whereby you need to pay yourself first. You need to set aside some amount. Is there a percentage that one pays themselves?
It is good for my experience, and my advice would be, especially when you are starting off, you know, it depends with the income. For example, a person earning $1 million and a person earning 10,000, there could be, because the expenditure of a human being has an optimal point. For example, if you're earning 10 million shillings a month, there is a limit at how much you can spend. But on average, I would recommend the person earning the lowest, please make sure you set aside not less than 15% of your income.
Not less than 15%.
Exactly.
Let's take a call from David, who's calling from Thika. Good morning, David, and thank you for calling. To your question or comment. Good morning, David in Thika. To your question or comment?
Yeah, I have a question to ask.
Go right ahead.
Yeah, I was asking this question. If someone has a loan that is, maybe I've taken a loan of maybe 200,000 shillings, and I've already paid like 50,000, and I want to pay off the loan. So is it advisable for me to pay off the loan if I have all the money? Or I have to wait until the loan matures? I pay it like in a bit, comfortably. But if I have money somewhere, I've already made a deal somewhere, or have a business somewhere, is it advisable for someone to pay off the loan? And then the second question, I've heard you talking about loan is always must be for the business. There are people who take loan for land of to buy a plot? Is it advisable for someone to take loan and then you buy plot, or is not advisable? The third question, and the final one, if someone has a wife, and your wife can access money easily somewhere. So this is not my personal loan, is for family or a house loan, or let's call it house business. Can your husband or your wife take a loan for you? Thank you.
Much, David, some pertinent questions there. Starting off, first of all, with paying off loans. When you've taken a loan and you want to pay it off quickly, is that advisable?
For me, it is advisable. A loan is a chain. Get out of it if you have the money.
Okay.
Yeah.
What about in instances where possibly that money could be doing something else that would bring in more money than paying off the loan?
Like the one of buying a plot?
Maybe.
That question about buying a plot, I would consider it a plot, shares, putting money in a fixed deposit. All those are investments. Mm-hmm. Investment, you invest surplus. You don't invest from a hole.
You invest
from the fruits.
Yes.
Therefore, it's good to take a loan that generates that surplus. Mm-hmm. And this surplus comes from business. My advice is, no one has control over investment. Investment, you can put in the money, it can vanish. You can put in the money, you can get double. And since, or therefore, you don't have control of which direction the money will take, it is good to always take loans to finance your business. And therefore, the surplus from the business, you can invest. But it's not advisable to do what I'd call margin trading. You take a loan to invest. And therefore, you make some money here, and then you return the other money. What if you buy that plot, or you take a loan to buy the plot? For example, now, in the economy, the plots are no longer appreciating as much. What if you take that million to buy a plot, and then the plot, there is no buyer, and is not appreciating? It therefore means all the interest you are paying every month is actually lost money.
Okay, final question on taking a loan for a spouse. Very briefly, is that advisable or not?
Taking a loan for a spouse, I don't want to break homes. But definitely, there should be a very distinct line, especially when a spouse is one person, so to say, or as a Christian, we are told so. Therefore, if you are taking it especially to expand something or to bring in more income, then you may consider doing so. But unfortunately, in many instances, those kind of loans have led to increased incomes, but also broken homes.
Increased broken homes. Thank you very much, Ndindi Nyoro, who's an economist, for filling us in on loans and investments. And that's where we'll have to wind up because of time. But before I wind up, Michelle Ngela, I don't know if you had any questions or comments regarding loans and money.
I mean, the only comment is this is a very, very incisive interview, because so much information guys don't know about loans and how to pay them back. You know, I think it's really good for finances. I've learned a thing or two.
Yeah, I think we should carry on the conversation, because we didn't even touch on cooperatives and